97.3 City FM. Relevant radio.
Always. In regard to our plans, we will undertake the following. Construction of an ultra-modern new teaching hospital for the University of Ghana Medical School. Start the processes for the establishment of regional hospitals in the Eastern and Upper East regions. We will continue work on the regional hospital project in Wa in the Upper West region. We will upgrade the Central and Volta regional hospitals into teaching hospitals to expand. We will upgrade the Central and Volta regional hospitals into teaching hospitals to expand the scope for training medical doctors and other healthcare professionals. We will commence work on 12 new district hospitals at Dodowa, Abetifi, Fomina, Garu, Kumau, Sekendi, Salaga, Teba, Beji, Madina, etc. As we look at this, we've been consistent with our record over the last 4 years. In addition, we will initiate the process, the necessary processes towards the construction of the polyclinics, especially in the districts as well as the regions that currently lack such facilities. And embarking on this journey of expanding assets, we'll also begin to explore new modalities of public-private partnerships in health investment in a manner that brings new investment, expertise, and technology into the health sector, providing our citizens a variety of options of where they access their healthcare services. Mr. Speaker, there's an ongoing review of the operations of the National Health Insurance Scheme. Our goal is to ensure a more efficient, expanded, and sustainable delivery. We will work to reduce costs and economic overall system and transformation. It is important to be mindful of segments of our society who, for reasons of social, cultural, or economic circumstances, become vulnerable and marginalized. It is for this reason we have created the new Ministry for Gender, Children and Social Protection. The ministry is to coordinate and implement the numerous government social intervention programs aimed at the poor and disadvantaged in our society. Let me say again for emphasis that the mandate of this ministry is not to promote gay rights as some segments of society. We have also taken stock of all the existing social intervention programs and relocated them directly under the Ministry of Gender, Children and Social Protection. This will enable us to develop a more efficient targeting mechanism and eliminate duplication and manipulation of the existing fragmented schemes. The new ministry will have oversight of the Disability Council and will take steps to integrate fully our challenged brothers and sisters in the mainstream of national life. We have shown a commitment to this program by appointing Dr. Dana as a Minister of State. Mr. Speaker, we are mindful of the fact that poor planning and a lack of adequate preparation can derail our efforts to qualify for and participate effectively in these and other competitions. We will roll out a number of policies to unearth and develop sporting talents to feed our various national teams. And these will include provision of incentives to metropolitan, municipal, and district assemblies to establish at least one well-resourced sports and athletic facility in every district. Reinvigoration of the traditional inter-schools and colleges sports competition programs. We will reserve some admissions to senior high schools for talented sportsmen and women and other creative students, among other interventions. Completion of the Cape Coast Stadium as promised by our late President John Evans Atta Mills. Restructuring and reorientation of the National Sports Authority to enhance its efficiency and effectiveness in the discharge of its mandate. Development of the lesser-known sporting disciplines, among others. Mr. Speaker, I stated in my address to the UN General Assembly last year that the youth are today's leaders and not future leaders. In order to enable our youth to realize their full potential and contribute to national development, we have fashioned our comprehensive programs, including but not limited to a 10 million Ghana Cedi Youth Jobs and Enterprises Development Fund, which will be launched to encourage and support young people to become successful entrepreneurs and create sustainable job opportunities for themselves. Jobs and Enterprises Centers will be established in all regions to help unemployed youth and those about to enter or prepare for the world of work. We will develop youth centers in districts to facilitate youth meetings, interactions, cultural programs, conferences, and inputs into district assemblies. This is the way on the Eastern Corridor Rural Fiber Optic Backbone Network project will be accelerated to add 584 kilometers of optic fiber stretching from Ho to Boko and linking 70 towns and routes to improve the quality of communication services in that area. With the ICT sector expanding at such a rapid rate, attention will be focused on measures to protect the privacy of the individual and individual personal data. We will also develop strategies to counter the growing threats of cyber attacks and other online security concerns, and accelerate preparations towards migration from analog to digital television transmission. The Better Ghana ICT project will be given a major boost this year. We shall commence the distribution of 400,000 laptop computers to schools and students. Roads. Mr. Speaker, we have clear plans for the roads and transport sector, which we will start implementing this year. These include the introduction of public-private partnership models on commercially viable routes along the Western, Eastern, and Central Corridor networks. Work is soon commencing on the northern segment of the Eastern Corridor Road, stretching from Otidamanku in the Volta region to Nakanduri in the northern region. This year, we expect to bring a significant point of completion many of the ongoing road projects, including the Kando Rabra Dambai Road, the Asankagwa Inchi Road, the Nabrongo Tumu Road, the Achimota Ofanko Road, Madina Pantan Road, the Sahwam Suhum Apeja Road, La Teshi Road, the Soman Road, and Apaso Kitampo Roads, just the energy of petroleum. Millions of Ghanaians and businesses are today experiencing very erratic and frustrating electricity supply. It is a situation that I am deeply concerned about and to which I have devoted considerable energy to solve it. This is especially because compounding the system, the problem of unstable power supply is an equally worrying issue of unreliable water supply to some communities. The current developments do not reflect the investments and progress we have been making in the area of electricity generation. What should be our success and rather augment available generation capacity has unfortunately been undermined by a number of unforeseen developments. We have made good progress in fixing the damage done to the West African gas pipeline. We only to experience a drawback when nearly 600 kilometers of the pipeline was inundated with seawater. Mr. Speaker, in a frantic effort to pump the seawater out, two of our most experienced engineers lost their lives tragically in an underwater accident. Permit me to use this occasion to send my deepest condolences to the bereaved families. The repercussions of the incapacitated gas pipeline has brought near total darkness to our neighbors in Togo and Benin, and have led to the loss of over 250 megawatts of our own electricity supply in Ghana. Mr. Speaker, work on the West African gas pipeline is now planned for completion in April 2013 this year. As President, I'm adequately aware of the challenges and the extreme discomfort that this is causing to the generality of our people and businesses. Indeed, Mr. Speaker, this situation causes me sleepless nights. We have had to work around the clock to bring many plants into operation earlier than we had scheduled, while we await the restoration of the plants affected by the absence of gas from the West African gas pipeline from the Takoradi T3 thermal plant, expected by the end of February. Another 130 megawatts from the Bui Hydroelectric Power Project by the end of April, and an increase to 400 megawatts from Bui by the end of September. 2 megawatts will also come from a solar park built at Nabrongo by the end of February. With the addition of Takoradi T3 this month and the first power from Bui in April, our current deficit of about 200 megawatts at peak hours should be sufficiently ameliorated. While this will give us comfort from the current unpleasant load shedding, the system will still be fragile with a slim margin of redundancy. Restoration of the West African gas pipeline and Asogli coming back on stream will give us a better margin of comfort. Mr. Speaker, MPs new laptop with full internet connectivity. To facilitate communication between their offices and their constituents, as promised in the NDC manifesto. In my first term, we'll seek to strengthen Parliament by establishing the Democracy Fund proposed by the Constitutional Review Commission to provide sustainable funding for Parliament and the independent governance institutions and other pro-democracy governance bodies. We'll strengthen the committees of Parliament by ensuring that the chairpersons and ranking members of Parliament are accorded recognition consistent with their status and responsibilities as recommended by the CRC. We will this year commence a feasibility study for the construction of a new parliamentary chamber block on the premises of the State House. We will also explore appropriate housing for MPs in order to guarantee their safety and security. Decentralization and local government. Mr. Speaker, effective decentralization in governance and decision making starts with the presidency. I've therefore instructed the Cabinet Office to ensure that Cabinet meetings rotate between Accra and the regional capitals. Yeah. By this, millions of our citizens outside Accra will have the opportunity each month to witness and participate in the process of decision making directly. Mr. Speaker, during my first term as President, every effort will be made to ensure that some of the far-reaching proposals emanating from the Constitutional Review Committee's report on decentralization, such as the election of district chief executives at the local level, is given the needed
impetus. It must not be business as usual.
Mr. Speaker, we may be confronted with many challenges as a nation, but our collective resolve is far greater than those challenges. Mr. Speaker, as I said on that eventful day of my inauguration as President, change does not happen overnight. And sometimes, despite whatever progress has been put in motion, it will appear to be darkest before the dawn of the new day makes that progress visible. In such times, I count on you, my countrymen and women, to maintain the faith and trust that you have placed in me as your President. And I promise you, I will not let you down. We acknowledge our abundant faith in the Almighty God and His bountiful mercies on our nation. Mr. Speaker, God's divine favor is on Ghana. Yeah. We have no cause to fear. With God in our boat, we smile at the storm. I know we will not fail our country, and I know that the good Lord will not fail us either. God bless Ghana. Thank you very much.